also. And I'm not going to say much at the start, because I think it's important we keep time for the question, comments after the film. Usually I find the film stimulates a lot of reflection and discussion. But just if you want to know a bit about I guess, why I made this film, perhaps, and where I'm coming from. So my background is in clinical psychology and cultural psychiatry. So my interest has been in this area, and I've been working in different cultural mental health and governmental health related issues. And I guess as proceeding in my career as an academic, I realized that my work is very much about advocacy and working with people with lived experience on mental health issues. And I started feeling that only writing papers, although it's very important for our career and going to conferences and all these important things we have to do, I was not able to really reach to other audiences, the no scholarly audiences, and try to have an impact. So then I decided to start using my also background in arts. I've done theater for many years, and I done photography, and then I decided to leave my job for a bit, go to Manchester and doing a master's in visual anthropology, ethnographic documentary. So this film actually is part of my MPhil in ethnographic documentary. So if you want to see my MPhil dissertation, you can have a look at this as well. So it is basically part of a master's, and my focus was in human rights and mental health, which is one of my main interests. So the documentary I'm going to be showing now, Breaking the Chains, is based in Indonesia, as Sabina just said, and is my feature documentary, 64 minutes, but it's a part of a series I'm making about this issue of human rights violations against people with mental illness in different countries. So if you go in a movement website, you can find more information. So there is the two films that I'm making. And when I say I'm making, I make everything. Unfortunately, I don't have budget. I wish I was Gates, a little bit of money like that, but I don't. So I have to support everything myself. But it's a series about, if you go, Breaking the Chains, if you can click there. So it's a series. Another film I'm making is about actually together with a young man. His artistic name is Anto, who was chained, again in Indonesia, was chained on and off many times because the family was concerned. He ran away before, he almost killed himself, so the family was very concerned. And I went to film him. We make together a documentary, a short story about him, himself, try to reflect about his experience of being chained. And actually, when we made the film, I was supposed to film him after he was released. So he was talking in the past about something which had happened in the past. At that point, he was learning English. He wanted to go to university. He's a very talented painter, so we worked a lot about his artwork. But actually, after I left, thinking that this was his past, after I left only, I think it was 3 months later, we were in touch via Facebook and Skype. And then for a while, I didn't hear from him, so I got worried. And my colleague in Indonesia, a psychiatrist, she informed me that actually he had been chained again. So in spite of going to university, this man, even today, he gets chained on and off by his family. So I think it's interesting to kind of see the way this, the reasons behind why this actually happens. And the third documentary I'm making is about human rights more an international perspective, which is about looking at these issues from a different perspective, as human rights violations happen in every country, in different shapes, different forms, but they happen everywhere. So I wanted to kind of capture this happens in UK, in Canada, in a country with a better funded health system, but it's still a problem. So if you want, you're interested in this issue, if you go on the website, you can sign up to the mailing list, and then you can hopefully soon see also the other documentaries I'm making. So I think we might get started. 64 minutes is a bit of time, and then we will have like half an hour for comments and questions. Yeah, thank you.
And it was a bit traumatic.
Yeah, so thank you very much for a very interesting film. Because I don't know about this kind of situation in Indonesia. Like what you said, there are 57,000 people are in Pasung. And in Cianjur, it's not very far from Jakarta, actually. So I don't know in other places. It's only like maybe from Jakarta to Cambridge, I believe. Cianjur is not very far. My question is actually very basic. I would like to know, like these people, from when they become mentally ill? Is it from they were born, or were there any specific situation that made them become mentally ill? I don't know, because what I understand is that there are different levels of mental ill as well. For example, like in ASEP, I think that he's quite smart, actually. I mean, he has a quite a good hallucination. I mean, the hallucination is... and then, I don't know, I believe that in the end of the film, he was singing. He's trying to sing. He pretending to speak in English, I think, right? Yeah. Thank you.
So it's a very general question. So I think we will need a lecture on mental health problems to cover this, the question you're asking. But looking at the people in this film, the majority of people in Pasung in Indonesia usually have some kind of diagnosis of psychotic disorder. So they kind of got usually schizophrenia. So like ASEP is more obvious, but also Yaya also had a diagnosis of schizophrenia. Both of them became unwell Yaya, I think when she was 24, so 17 years before she got changed, and there's always like a kind of a little stage of psychosis, and the ASEP became also unwell when he was like 16, 17. So there are different kind of mental health problems, and the schizophrenia, some people are like that when they are very young, but you know, it's not unusual to become unwell around 22 years of age. So there are different mental health problems and different paths as for any health condition of some sort. So there isn't an answer, but the people in Pasung, generally speaking, have got pretty serious mental health issues, and that's why the family are concerned about them running away, or some of them have run away, like ASEP, who was for 2 years missing from home, and they are chained, so many of them have got some kind of hallucination and situation of this kind. But we can talk after a little more about mental health issues, as it's a very big area.
Thank you for screening this very interesting movie. Could you tell us more about the effects that chaining people have on their mental health from a scientific point of view? Because I imagine, like, aside from the human rights perspective, there's an adverse effect on their hallucinations and so on. So do we know what it brings in terms of bad, you know, aggravating their health? Mm.
So for this particular situation in Pasung, as far as I know, I don't know of any study that has been relating and looking specifically about the consequences specific as a study. But if you even just look at the people in this film, and that's why I also wanted to show some things, like the guy who gets washed, and then you can see, I wanted to show the fact that he could not stand up anymore, and the mother, the psychiatrist who was visiting, was asking about his eye, which was very puffy, and you know, about not talking anymore. So that is a classical situation where he was locked in a room, even by daytime, and that's why I wanted to show that it was daytime, he was closed in the room, so he was starting losing. So even if there were the mental health problems, but the chaining itself and the being caged in these spaces was actually creating all sorts of physical problems, and that's why many of them die. So in the film, three people die, and they have a lot of physical consequences of the poor conditions where they are kept. This person has stopped to be able to walk, and it's not unusual for people in Pasung to actually lose the ability of walking because they are chained, that they cannot move. There are different practices. So Yaya, the woman, she was able to move around, so the chain allowed her movement, but other people are just not able to move anymore, so they actually lose even the basic, you know, kind of physical conditions. And Yaya became very passive, and that's also what I wanted to show. So her being chained in the room, she was totally, totally passive. So the family was protecting her, because before she was chained, she got lost. She was, you know, in danger, and the parents were, the father was afraid she might be destroying something. But then when she became chained, she was totally passive. She did not answer any of the questions that Nuramid was asking her, even basic things like, have you eaten? Something very basic, she could not answer. But then, if you look at the film, in just in 3 weeks' time, so when you see her again, and she's dressed, with like you know, is a slamming desk. She starts, though she doesn't say much, but you can see her smiling. She starts addressing, even just saying yes, no, but she starts answering. She was taking the washing from outside. So even just that short period of being free already had a very good effect on her symptoms. So the film kind of wanted to, I wanted to show how these practices can actually make people worse, if not kill them. Like the Asep at the beginning of the film and the healing center who died. I haven't found out how he died, but the air conditions in that health center were pretty bad. Like if you see people with all these terrible skin conditions, and the imam there was trying his best, but they had the little resources, was very crowded, so okay, they die often of just diarrhea, something as simple as that, but in those contexts, if you don't have care, they are deadly. So yeah, chaining has got a lot of effect on health and mental health. Yeah. So there is a question in the back.
Well, a couple of related questions. First of all, what would actually be the legal framework in theory in Indonesia for, would there be provision for people who were seriously ill to be, if necessary, compulsorily detained for treatment? And secondly, are the models for healthcare for such seriously ill people, are they on more on the model of institutional care? It was referred to several people being committed to mental hospitals or for what in this country would be termed care in the community, which there are disputes about which is the better approach.
Yeah.
So I was just wondering what the institutional and legal framework was.
So from a legal perspective, like Pasung, this kind of particular practice is illegal in Indonesia since, I think, 1976. Actually, so from a legal perspective, this is illegal. In spite of that, it's been going around in the country since a very long time. As in other institution, it is possible to kind of set in people in institution if there is possible danger to themselves or to others. The thing is, there is not really mechanism to regulate this. So people, like, you know, and it's the doctor decision, and often the family decision, actually, to the person to be in institution. So they people can be just dumped in an institution, so to speak. And like when I was showed about the title at the end, when I say they went inside for an undetermined period, and that's the language actually was used when I inquired about them, and that's something not atypical, like people get in the institution for this undetermined period, so nobody knows how long they can be, and many people are in institution forever, like they're just kept in institution. Often institution in Indonesia, there is not many of them, there's not many psychiatric hospital, but when they are often kept chained, also inside the hospital, because there is not enough people working, there isn't, psychiatric nursing is a very kind of new thing, there are very, very few staffs for patients, so often institutions are unable to cope with the demand they have, and they resort in a pasung inside institution, and hospital very overcrowded, and there is lots of people usually are underfed because there is not enough money even for buying food. They have a very basic treatment, so even the people in the film, they all had very, very basic psychotropic drugs because that's what the country can afford. And so that is a real issue. Things are changing, though, slightly. So there has been more Indonesia. That's why I wanted to show Indonesia. Compared to other countries, actually, I was in Philippines recently making a documentary about violence against women, so talk later. And so it was not related to this issue. But as it happens, sadly, I was traveling to a little island. Actually, I was in Cebu, which is a big island, and I was in a part in the north. When I was there, I was told, in that island, Philippines, more than 7,000 islands, there is a man who's been chained, like in your film. So we went to, actually, I was with a psychiatrist, so I was doing a documentary with a psychiatrist, and she always has medication with her. And so we went in this island, And we went to meet this man who was exactly in this kind of conditions. And in Philippines, they are just starting now a mental health law. They're doing a lot of advocacy for having a mental health law legislation, which is not existing at the moment, and looking at human rights violations. So Indonesia, in some way, is more advanced compared to other low mid-income countries in terms of acknowledging that an issue and start investing more in terms of improving community mental health. But as you said, there are issues also with community mental health in terms of also therefore resourcing. So in the documentary as well, you see, they have to travel long, long hours to just go to see one person. So the kind of resources necessary in this kind of country, even for the basic community mental health, will be enormous. And with 1%, I think, of the health budget spent in mental health, it's not gonna happen anytime soon. But there are progresses. Thank you for the question.
Quite a few questions, really, but can we start with your lasting impression of making this film? Mm. What was the one thing that kind of stands out for you, or?
To be honest, when I was watching the film, I watched this film many times, so I've been editing it. In fact, I just finished it, but I'm still taking notes about a few things I want to change, small things. I think I need to stop at some point. So I watched this film so many times, and still, like today I was watching it, I just feel that kind of warmth, like real love for the people in the film. And I think the last thing, I get emotional. The last thing is seeing about how few people with a lot of passion and the determination, with the very few resources, how much they can do and how much really can be achieved, but when you really believe in it. So the warmth they have, they went a long way. I was with these guys for a month and a half, which was the length of my visa. So I was with them all the time to get as much as I could. And these guys worked nonstop. Like, you know, they come at 8 o'clock to pick me up like a zombie, because I had to also, every night, take the tapes and capture my tape. So I went by the very late every night. And we were out all day with the scooters, going around. That for me was only 45 days. That was their life. And that I think is what would be the strongest thing for me. I really believe in people, and what just people who believe in what they are doing, they can do so much. And that's, I think, probably been the most lasting thing for me. The relationship that builds up between them and the community, how important the trust is, because these people really were trusted in the community, and that's why they were able with very using simple language, using very simple means, to make a lot of changes, to convince the family, to give it a go, try to find another solution. And that is very important, how much trust is fundamental. So there are, it still is watching now. It's a difficult situation, a difficult, sad situation, but I think it's a hopeful film after all. It's about thinking, I think can change, and I think they are changing, but there is a lot to be done.
So in the movie itself, the word love was used quite a few times, and that was quite striking in the kind of, in the Western world, we don't kind of associate with that word so much. Did that strike, or was this lost in translation, or no?
Well, you speak English, but from Sundanese. You from Indonesia? Yeah. No. Yeah. But you were no. But it translated correctly, as far as I know. So no, actually, I wanted to make sure that part. So they repeated this routine, they repeated of basic things, and I want to make sure it was there, because it was not just about medication. So I didn't want to think these people go around. They were not getting any support from any pharmaceutical company, I said here. And the film did not have any kind of support of the kind, for sure. So there was not like a campaign for medication. That was a part of what these people at the stage they needed to kind of be able to just start functioning slightly. But that part about recovery, really about getting them reintegrating in the community and just loving them, taking care, was always in the discourse. And I wanted to make sure it was there, because it was part of what they really were trying to do. That very simple things, like about even touching a person. One of the people I filmed, the Narim, in the forest, I filmed the mother was so old, poor thing. You know, she was like, you know, I was very sad for the mother, because she was very poor. And so there was, but this guy was in a cage where you can either, there was no door. I don't know if you notice, I tried to, but I don't know if people see that. But the cage doesn't have any door. So there is no way to get in and get out of that. It was put there with the idea that he will never come out. Yeah, and that kind of just the possibility of having a human contact. Imagine, we know from previous research, which will be not possible in today's ethics committee, but about the lack of just physical contact, how damaging it is. So that part is stressed a lot about Yagi in particular, getting her to be helping in the house. We see her helping the family. That little thing, cooking, and that is such a big thing when you've been living for 17 years inside a room. So that was very important. And you're right, though, but in our society, we take for granted, it's not part of our discourse. So that's interesting. Is that true?
What is the scale of the problem now?
So the statistic I reported was from last year. So obviously, this statistic always needs to. There was the first census. I'm moving through your camera. The first census in Indonesia where there was a question about physical restraint. So that is the first kind of official statistic we have on a national scale, which report to 57,000 people indicating they've been in Pasung.
In now, a population of?
Of 250,000. Million, pardon.
And so just by, if we did the numbers for schizophrenia at, I don't know, 1% lifetime prevalence, I'm just, what I'm trying to get my head around is people who end up in Pasung, if we were to extrapolate the psychopathology that they might be expressing, what would that extrapolate to? Would these be people who are, be in Broadmoor or Rampton for us? Or would these be people who might be on any, you know, on Mulberry Tree or rehab ward? You know, so did you get a sense that people in Pasung, were they, you know, people who had committed dangerous offences when mentally unwell? Or were these people, you know, so, because in a way, being locked up in Broadmoor is, for perhaps your entire life, is in way, okay, you're not chained, but it's not that different in a low-income country. It's the same version of that.
Yeah.
So I guess that's one of the things that kind of I was trying to work out. Did you have a sense of that?
So again, there is not a lot of literature about Pasung. We can base the statistics. There's one study which I think reported 87% of people had a diagnosis in Pasung had a diagnosis of schizophrenia. So that's the kind of scenario from a medical perspective. The reason why these people are in Pasung, from what we know so far, but it's the same thing emerging in the film, are usually because of fear. They go together. The fear of the person doing harm to themselves was a big one, but also doing damage to others. So there have been instances where they have done something that actually was the community to put in pressure for them to be chained because they were concerned. I didn't put much of that because I didn't want to use this film in a way which can increase the stigma towards people with mental illness, because unfortunately the media, and I'm a bit annoyed about the media in this regard, the only time that mentally ill people are in the media usually is when they do something which is about being violent to others, although we know people with mental health problems are more victims of violence than being them the perpetrator. But still, I don't know, I haven't seen anything in the media about people who have mental health problems actually being the victim of violence. Usually we only have got these portraits. And my film, I didn't want to emphasize. You get the father of Oyaya says, "I know I'm afraid that she destroyed something," and the mother of Narim says something about him destroying things. So you get that they are scared about them doing damage to others. But I did not show, for example, that Adad, who is the guy who was kept half buried, he said we're going with a machete. He says that. The other guy, the first one, Narim, at the beginning, the father says, "I'm afraid of him." That's the only thing you see in the film when he's washing. And he says, "I'm afraid of him." I think he took a scissor once and he tried to stab his father. So the father was very scared of him. And but I didn't, you know, emphasize this much. But not all of them, like Azep hasn't done anything on that side, but he burnt down the house, which could have resulted. He didn't want to kill anybody because he explains he had this hallucination about a wife, which he doesn't have, and Mango and all the rest. But it could have resulted in, if the family had been in a, they didn't escape, they could have died. So there is this side about people who be possibly dangerous, but not all of them. And the discourse overall is much more about people being in danger themselves, because they are, if you're there in the street, and many people with mental problems end up in the streets, even in UK, and they are a possible victim of violence.
others might have questions as well.
Yeah.
So,
well, thank you for your question. Oh, wow. Don't fight over the microphone.
Thank you so much for a very insightful and inspiring documentary. I really enjoyed it. I wanted to actually pick up on something that you said, but also ask you a specific, more anthropologically based question, I suppose. In relation to love and to touch, and the importance of it indeed, we did see in big European study and in a global study that we did a great variation, actually, between countries, but also within the context of a certain country. And in Europe, for instance, there were great differences between the more Mediterranean-based countries, for instance, and indeed Britain, where touch was more permitted or less permitted, for instance, and the expression of love through touch. And I think perhaps in the culture of a certain country or even within a country context, north, south, east, west, for instance, or different communities even, I think that can greatly vary as well. And then the professionalism attached to and I suppose ethical frameworks attached to professionalism can really greatly influence that as well. So we did see in certain countries that there was that allowance of expression through touch, not only in mental health care, but also in elderly care, for instance, because a lot of older people were talking about loneliness, and what they missed most was not only talking to people, but also touch. They missed touch an awful lot, just a gesture of humanity, really, of shared humanity, and the allowance of that in a certain context. So I think that's a really important one indeed to perhaps further research and the impact that has. But I was wondering in terms of Indonesia, because this is a very community-based, and we spoke already very briefly about institutions, but I was also wondering if you saw different contextual variations, if you had the possibility to gain a bit more an insight in that, because it's from Sabrina, I know as well how varied and dispersed Indonesia is, and also from our global studies we did notice the potential for an awful lot of difference within or between countries, but also within countries, dependent on communities, education. We saw education on a number of occasions, the importance of that, rural versus urban, etc., etc. I wonder if you saw varieties there of better care or lesser care, for instance, across communities or settings within that context.
So my study was based mainly in Jeonju, so thank you for that. And that's where my kind of research was mainly based. And I know that in Jeonju, which is a very big area in West Java, there was only one psychiatric hospital, which was near Jeonju, the city. So in a rural area, as in most of this country, but in most country, there is not much happening still in Indonesia. What there is usually few psychiatric hospital, but they usually are in the biggest cities. So in Jeonju, was in Bandung, and then in Jakarta, there is the hospital in Jakarta, so in the big cities. When you go in the rural area, because also they are so dispersed, so many people, like in these little villages, where often there is no road to go, there is primary care is what is kind of the way to access mental health care, but then people in primary care are not usually educated about mental health, and therefore they are unable to provide much assistance. So primary care is really what is mainly offered. Then there is areas like Aceh. So Aceh, because of the tsunami, there was a lot of presence of international organized bodies. In fact, Aceh is where the first program for Pasung, Bebas Pasung, Aceh Bebas Pasung, Aceh Free from Pasung, was the first campaign, was actually in Aceh, because in Aceh, when there was a tsunami, there was international organization in the area, and people were exposed to Pasung, and then the international body started spending some money to get the infrastructure for people with mental health problems. The governor of Aceh decided to start a program to eliminate Pasung, and that's actually where it started. So there were, I think still there are, maybe you might know more about it, more resources in Aceh, because sometimes the side effect of disaster is to improve mental health care. So, but there is, again, it's much more institutional, a community mental health still, but it is improving in community mental health. Jakarta was there recently, is another area where there is a lot more community mental health based, and also educating primary health care. In fact, one of my PhD students, I was talking before, I'm very proud, she became director of public mental health center, and they are doing a lot of education for primary care for mental health. So things are happening in the sense, but it is still a big division between rural and the city, and in the cities where most of the mental health care is happening. And it is mainly institutional and mainly based on medication. The good thing about Indonesia is, and I think actually is I do a lot of research in Asia, and so far I think it's the country where I've seen more the activism of people with the lived experience of mental health problems. It's a lot of good organization, people like in this case, getting together and try to make changes, have a very strong voice, which I think is very important. I think it's having a big impact in the country. So there is a large presence, which is missing, for instance, in Philippines, where there is very little of this. So Indonesia has got quite a strong advocacy and lived experience activism, which I think is making quite a big impact. Mm.
Good. Yeah, thank you very much. So going right off of that question, yeah. You know, it's great to see there's more activism. Mm. I was curious, you know, those people were very inspiring who were, you know, had the experience with mental health problems. But do you know, like among students or culturally among families, is pasun an issue that's becoming more and more talked about? I got a sense from the film that it was seen as an unfortunate circumstance or a hopeless problem, per se. I was just wondering if culturally there are more campaigns to make it more aware among Indonesians.
I don't know. It's interesting for me. Like often when I show this film, there are Indonesians in the room. A lot of people from Indonesia actually don't know about pasung, or they've heard about pasung, but they've never actually seen anything about pasung. And this thing is interesting on its own because you will imagine, but you will expect, but not because this happens mainly in rural area. It was also in Jakarta, and not more very very long ago, but people were not exposed. And it's low socioeconomic classes, so students usually. Are not from the same classes where these are happening. Although, say that, if you look at happiness, also why I had it, the guy in the healing center, he speaks in English, and that's very unusual in these areas. So we don't know who the guy is, unfortunately he's dead, so we are not gonna know. We tried to help him, and the family have put him there. We don't know who they are, but they definitely were educated, because for him to speak English means in that area means that they were educated people. So even educated people, like, you know, can still put their sons in a healing center chain. But there is more happening in Indonesia. There is definitely more knowledge about it. But I don't think it is something widespread. But maybe we can hear from you guys what's happening in terms of there is much. I mean, when I was there, I didn't see much. And also the media. I was looking about what else is there in the media, and I could only find some very small projects about pasung, mainly just showing the problem, nothing actually about showing that Indonesia actually had a program to stop pasung, so there was not much knowledge about bebas pasung, but what is your experience about this?
I think in Indonesia, since 2010, the Indonesia Bebas Pasung, Free Indonesia from Pasung program has been in the media quite a lot. Mm. So a lot of students, psychology students, medical students have gained awareness through media channels, and I think it is a very important thing. Mm. However, changing political landscapes, there are always barriers to the continuation of such programs, because I think one of the patients also mentioned he was given a card that allowed free healthcare. Yeah. However, apparently the Free Indonesia from Pasung program had to be extended. It did not meet its goal of ending this year because some of the people on Pasung have no card, no healthcare card, which means they cannot gain treatment. Mm. So such issues still happen.
Yes, so basically, because in the film they say that by 2015 Pasung will be free, they hope will be free from Pasung, from Indonesia will be free from Pasung, because the the program was about eradicating Pasung by this year, but as that is not happening by this year. But I think it was a bit, was not going to happen. But this thing, it required changes at different levels, but definitely resources as well. And like in Cheongju, after I left, they stopped giving this card, so they could not have any more medication for free. I think now it's back again, but that makes an enormous impact. Now the new goal is 2017, eradicate Pasung by the next 2 years. So I'm actually on Friday, I'm going to meet a producer because I want to go back in that year and try to see if it's been eradicated. I don't think it will be eradicated, just because this thing takes a long time, but seeing what are the successes, what actually has worked in Indonesia, that has made some changes, and what has not worked. And also because this can be a learning lesson for many other countries with similar issues. Of this level, of other level in terms of learning, with having not much resources, what actually works and what doesn't. So I'm hoping to go back and maybe we come back here in 3 years' time and show what's happening. And I want to go back to see them and I want to film what's happening to them. I can't film all of them because they died and hopefully nobody else is going to die. But those who are alive and okay and they agree to be filmed again, I'll try to go there and see what's happening in their life. It'd be nice,
actually. Yeah, I got one more question. When you're talking about Pasung and when Indonesia there's a debate over Pasung, does that include the physical restraint that you refer to in public institutions, or is it just the restraints that we've seen mostly in the film, you know, among families in rural areas? Because the 57,000, you know, assuming this is a correct figure or approximation, does that include or not the public hospitals where people are actually chained in a little room?
Usually, I mean, Pasung is about restraining, so that can happen everywhere, although usually it's referred more in the community level. So, I think statistics are always difficult, and there was a census, so the people in a family had to say if somebody in their family had been in Pasung. Now, I'm sure not all families will know if one of the relatives was in hospital that they actually were being chained. I'm sure doctors don't go around telling we are chaining your son or your daughter or your father. So I won't imagine a statistic is comprehensive of everybody in it being chained, including institutions. But some of them will have been in the statistic because probably they were chained also before or after they went in the institution. Wow, this is very exciting. Yeah.
You go first.
Okay. Yeah, just a quick question anyway. One thing, I was interested that most of the people in Pasung. they were men, weren't they, in your film? Really. Now, is that typical? Is that a sort of reflection of how it is?
Yeah. So mostly people in Pasung, again, statistics take it for what it is, but what we have so far, mostly it is male. Probably partially because of the fear about violence or danger. Yeah. So obviously, people tend to be more scared of men than female, but it tends to be more male.
Yeah. Okay. And the second thing I would like to know is what was the impact on you of having to actually make that film, and how did you sort of deal with the feelings that it must have evoked?
I'm a psychologist, and I thought I was prepared to deal. I mean, I was prepared in some ways to deal, at least I was prepared to deal with mental health problems because I've been working in institution before, so I was prepared for that. And my employer at the time, Erminia, he was working on Pasung since many years, so I'd been exposed in some way to him and my colleagues to the work there. So I was familiar with it, but you know, something is knowing intellectually about something is to be faced by the suffering. So it was challenging, and I was there on my own, I was totally on my own, I didn't have anybody with me. Maybe it would have been nice having somebody to go back to and sharing something, but I don't know, I think it was hard, but I guess to put things in perspective, because in the end, you know, as much as it was hard, it was nothing compared to what they were going. But one of the things I found harder for me was actually seeing the family, how much the family were suffering, and that's what was not prepared. So I was somehow expecting to see the people who were victims of Pasung, and they were chained, they were caged. So I was And that was really a lot of pain. But then there was the pain of the family around them, which in my stupid, naive imagination, I suppose, I thought, you know, there is the victim and the family are the bad people who are keeping them chained. But then when I went there, I was feeling this family were as much as in pain as the people in Pasung were. And that was challenging because they were desperate and they wanted to be helped and they just did not know what to do. And that was hard because you feel how powerless you can be and then how much work he needs to change the situation. But then it was so rewarding, actually. I was looking, I was thinking, wow, I was so lucky to have the chance to do this. I was so lucky to be able, although it took her so long, but to get my visa to go there, to get the Ministry of Health to supporting my project, thanks to the center I was affiliated with. To have these people just being so generous with me, just always taking me with them, totally having total trust in me, and you know, be able to just be there. I mean, I've been so fortunate to have this opportunity. So, yeah. But it's challenging, also looking at now.
We have time for one.
Thank you for the question. For the last question. We're going to go for dinner together, so don't have a question.
Yeah. No, just a quick question. Because I know that in other health problems, for example, reproductive health, because you know that in Pasung, the family usually bring the patient first to Al Hikmah, like you showed, so to the spiritual healing. And in the case of reproductive health, for example, the government and the NGOs try to work together with the midwife, with the dukun, so with the those kind of alternative medication. So if they go to this kind of midwife and then dukun and others, they will deliver something that is actually at least medically approved. And I don't know what is the case about Pasung or this mental ill. Does the government or the NGO also work with the Al Hikmah? For example, so if a family brings one of the members of the family who have a mental ill problem, and then they don't just give like a spiritual like reading some verses from the Quran, but also try to give them. Like you said, the importance of love, the importance of touch, and the importance of medication as well. Do they work
I've been writing a few papers in my life about spirituality and mental health because actually I mean, it's not only Indonesia. Like it's interesting to see how compared to other health area, mental health is like so far in terms of really integrating and reflecting over spirituality and religion and mental health and suicide. There's a lot of more work is on suicide and in spite of lots of people who want to kill themselves don't doing it because of spiritual kind of reason, religious or not, mental health, it had kind of totally ignores in some ways this kind of understanding. So I've been writing a lot about, one of my papers is called The Neglect of Spirituality, Mental Health and Suicide. So that's probably an issue we have across mental health, and there is a reason for it. There has been statistics showing that psychologists and psychiatrists are the most atheist of any kind of health professional. And so because that's what it did come out. So because probably most of people don't believe in anything spiritual or religious, they believe should not be addressed in their patients. I don't know. But so the issue is not only Indonesia. But in Indonesia, the program, Bebas Pasung, I guess, as most program, they say you should be working with the healers, local healer. But then good models of how this happens, there are some. Actually, one is in Manchester. There is one of my colleagues from Pakistan, Nusrat Hussain, who does good work with the local imam here in Manchester. So we have some models where the medical model and the spiritual model start to kind of work together, and I think it is possible, but it is difficult. So Bebas Pasung aims to work also with other healers, but that's often is hard because sometimes it becomes just a conflict of way of understanding what mental health is, what healing is. The group I was following, I like them, and I think I was talking before with Sabrina, they had a nice strategy because they themselves actually are not very religious, so they were not really talking about in religious terms, but they never confronted the religious belief of the family. So if you see in the film, in spite of the family giving all this kind of traditional healing things that they don't believe in, they never contested it. They always offered, okay, but can you also do this, or try also this. They was like, okay, you can continue that, but try also doing this other thing. And so they never challenged it, and they tried to collaborate with the local healers. So when we go in that forest, and they talk with the guy who said, I have to walk because usually he is in, or now it's dry season, otherwise we can go by car. He was a dukun, he was a traditional healer, and they were working together. So they were really trying to, with the all little means they had, this is a small group, but they were trying to engage with healers. The beginning of the film, we are in a healing center. To get access to this healing center is basically impossible. A lot of these healing centers, there are many of them in Indonesia, as in many other countries, and a lot of them got guards, guards, because you just, neither the family can go inside. It's just terrifying what might be happening inside there. It's hard to get access to many of these healing centers. This one, we had access because the imam of that center, he realized that his practices were not enough. They were healing some people in his experience, and the way he thought they were healed. I don't show it in the film, but it will be too disturbing. But anyway, he believed that it worked sometime, but not always. So they were actually, they wanted to have support from the KSJ staff to help them in terms of working together. So there are some experiences like this, but there is, again, a long way to go in terms of getting this system really working together. Thank you for your very thoughtful and interesting question. Actually, it's nice because it makes me think about. So thank you for giving me food for thoughts, and lovely meeting you all. And thank you, Sabina, for organizing
this.
Thank you.
Thank you for your time.